Good morning, and welcome to worship this Sunday morning at Mount Vernon Community Presbyterian Church. If you weren't expecting it, you certainly are noticing by now that I'm not at the church. COVID-19 has really made its presence known this week at Mount Vernon. I am the sole remaining member of the team that puts together the service on Sunday morning that's not dealing with COVID at the moment. I want to let you know that people are doing well, but that Ben Little and his family are in quarantine and recovering, that Phil Hurd had contact with some folks that had COVID and is awaiting results of his testing, and that Lynn Jameson has tested positive for COVID, and so she's going to be at home for a few days. So please keep the team in your prayers. Make sure you check in on them. Make sure that they're doing well. And if they have any needs, I know that the people of Mount Vernon reach out and help each other. So it's an unusual week. It's a new experience for me, at least here at Mount Vernon, to be recording the message at home. But thank you for tuning in and for being part of this great worshiping community. First of all, this morning, it's my responsibility to share the call for the congregational meeting. Hopefully by now you've received a letter from the church that it's necessary for us to hold this meeting, and because of COVID restrictions, we need to do it remotely. And so this is the call that the session has issued. The session calls for a congregational meeting. Because of COVID-19 restrictions, it'll be necessary to meet via Zoom on your computer or on your phone. The congregational meeting will be held on Tuesday, January 12th at 7 p.m. The purpose of the meeting is to receive the report of the nominating committee, review church finances, and inform the congregation of the 2021 budget approved by the session. In addition to the call, I want you to know that the invitation and instructions on how to connect to the Zoom congregational meeting were included in that letter, and if you've not received that letter, they are available through the church office. The letter will be posted on the church webpage and also available at the church office. Well, let's come together and let's worship God. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, thank you for the gift of the day, the gift of life, and the blessing of fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. Even if we're not together in person, we know that you are present with each of us in spirit, and we are no further away from one another than your embrace. So, Lord, bring us together this day. Let us hear your word, and let us respond in ways that honor you and bring blessing not only to our fellowship, but to the community and to the world in which we live. For we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, guys. So, obviously, also not at the church, but I figured I could interrupt Reverend Larry and sing a few songs, if you wouldn't mind singing along. Just a quick update on me. My test result came back negative, so I'm healthy. But still, you know, being safe and staying apart. So first song we're going to do is called Draw Me Close. The lyrics are in the description on YouTube. If you know the song, sing along. Go for it at home. I always enjoy the health. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Nothing else could take your place. to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way, bring me back to you. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way, bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. You're to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way, bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. The second song we're doing is Just a Closer Walk with Thee. Again, sing that if you want to. You don't have to. You can just listen to the sultry sounds of my voice. You're welcome.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through the days of toils and snares, if I fall, dear Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me will be no guide me safely, gently, o'er to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Before I share the text this morning, I just want to let you know that I am fully aware of the historic significance of the week that we've experienced. Believe me, and those of you who know me at all know this is true, there's lots that I would like to say about the developments in our nation. But frankly, I think we probably have all been bombarded with way too much information. And not as an escape, but to take a moment to focus on that on which we know we can trust, that we know we can believe, and that we know we can believe in, I'd like to focus on some things that I hope will have significant meaning to the people of Mount Vernon. Prior to all this week's developments, I'd planned to, for the next few weeks leading up to Lent, to walk through the book of Philippians. Again, often it's difficult for us as 21st century Gentiles to identify with first century history and with the developments in the church in the first century. But if we look close, we see that they were people like us. They had problems like us. They loved each other and challenged each other like us. And so I want to spend some time in this book, not as an interesting study, but rather to put on the glasses of looking to see how God ministers to people in times of challenge and in churches that are small, that are in the suburbs of great cities, that don't have particular power or wealth or influence, and yet are the beloved, the chosen people of God. So with that introduction, let me share the scripture for this morning. The first scripture is from Acts chapter 16. It introduces us to how Paul came to Philippi. And then the first 8 verses of the book of Philippians. Listen, this is God's word for you and me today. From Troas, we put out to sea and sailed straight from Samothrace and the next day on to Neapolis. From there, we traveled to Philippi, a Roman colony and the leading city of the district of Macedonia, and we stayed there for several days. On the Sabbath, we went outside the city to the river where we expected to find a place of prayer. We sat down and began to speak to the women who gathered there. One of those listening was a woman named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth from the city of Thyatira, who was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. When she and the members of her household were baptized, she invited us to her home. "If you consider me a believer in the Lord," she said, "come, stay at my house." And she persuaded us to do so. And then moving to Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and the deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It's right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. For whether I'm in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Lord, help us to listen not just to my words, but to your powerful meaning in your word, far beyond what I could say. And Lord, thank you for inviting us, just like those believers in Philippi, into your sweet fellowship of prayer and worship and praise and service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. With a lot of books that we read these days, there's a lot less than meets the eye. The hype usually exceeds the content. But with Philippians, the reverse is true. At first glance, it's just 4 chapters, and the chapters are brief. You can read the entire book of Philippians, I believe, in perhaps 10 or 15 minutes. I don't know if any of us, especially in the computer age, has taken that time to write that letter recently, but I know in my life there have been times, especially when I was writing to those that I loved and cared for, and was separated by some distance and some time, I may have written some letters that would be comparable in length to the book of Philippians. There's not a lot there. And at first glance, it seems to be a little more than informal greeting and meandering conversation between old friends. I didn't have or didn't choose to have some discipline in reading it, and I wrote it in common words, if I summarized it in a conversation with friends, I might do it this way. Thanks for the gift that you've sent to me. I'm so glad that Epaphroditus has gotten better. Oh, by the way, our mutual friend Timothy will be coming to see you soon, and did you know what's happened since I've been in prison? A lot of really unexpected people have become Christians, have become believers, palace guards, no less, and people from Caesar's own staff. Would you believe it? And this, with all those folks who are out there trying to make reputations for themselves as preachers at my expense, while I'm stuck here in jail. But it's okay, don't worry about it. Our gospel is so big and so powerful, it doesn't matter who tells it. If the word gets out, good results will follow. And what a great Lord we follow. Can you believe it? He had it all, the jewels of heaven, and he let go of all that just to give it up for us. Would that we could all be that humble and that serving. Speaking of which, you two ladies have got to stop fighting. We need you both, and the church needs you, and the gospel needs you, and most of all, I need you. But let me tell you who nobody needs. Those jerks who are trying to get you all bound up again in rules and regulations, tell you to do this and do that. Or God's not going to like you if you don't do what we say. Don't believe it for a second. Keep up all the good things that you've got going for you. It's quite a prize we're moving toward. Well, I gotta go now. I'll come and see you once I get out of this joint, and thanks again for the gift. I really needed it. And by the way, don't ever forget, rejoice. Do you hear me? Again, I say rejoice. There's a lot of joy out there. You just gotta look for it and make sure you see it. Take care. Bye-bye. Philippians, again, simple book, but I don't think it's just a conversation between old friends with little substance. As my pretend Paul would have said in what I just shared, don't you believe it for a second. Philippians may look like a simple chat, but it's a chat filled with dynamite and power. There's great stuff in this letter, but you got to take some time and put in a little effort to see it. We need to look beyond the casual tone and the off-the-cuff quality and look into Paul's heart, into what he really wants for these beloved friends, into his vision of what the gospel is all about, into his life circumstances when he wrote the letter. There's great themes in here, which is why Philippians is a favorite of so many believers. It talks about life and death, about victory over suffering, of joy in the face of trauma and difficulty, about humility as a model for our lives. We need to make sure that we don't miss these incredibly important lessons. One commentary says of Philippians is a book which we as 21st century American churchgoers both like and mistrust a little. We like it because its note of joy reverberates with us. We want joy. We never get enough joy. Anything that can tell us how to find joy is welcome, and we're ready to listen. But sometimes we're mistrustful of Philippians, though we wouldn't admit it publicly. We mistrust it because Paul doesn't tell us how to get rid of pain and problems. As a result, it's hard to imagine how he can teach us anything about joy, because in our minds, often our definition of joy is that problems have gone away. I think that's what joy is for a lot of us. It's the absence of the problems. When things are going our way, we have joy. When they're not, well, joy just isn't possible, or at least that's what we're tempted to think. But in fact, that's not how joy works at all, and that's not how it's understood in God's word. Joy is much stronger than the lack of problems. It connotes the presence of something important, not just the absence of what we don't like. Otherwise, Paul could never write as he does. Remember, he's writing this letter from a jail cell. I'm confident that to be incarcerated is never present. I won't take the time to tell the whole story, but I once had a rather rowdy group of students in my youth group when I was in New England. Some of them had seen contact with the police and had done some things that were not very helpful. And so I arranged with the local county sheriff to have Bible study in a jail cell with my youth group. But what I didn't tell them was he was going to lock the door and leave us in there for hours together. It became an interesting conversation. For a man as active and driven as Paul was, it must have been terrible to be locked up in a cell. There was so much he wanted, so much he needed to do. There were so many people that hadn't heard the gospel, and yet all he could do was while the days and make the most of them in that one small space. And then there's the emotional pressure, the anxiety. While he had high hopes of being released, this was no means of certainty. He could just as well remain in jail for years, or as became the case, he could be executed. He's obviously thinking about death, as it becomes clear in the first chapter. And there was the physical problem. Paul doesn't say much about this, but reading between the lines here and in others of his letters, it seems likely that he wasn't well at the time. We're told in Corinthians he has a thorn in the flesh. Whatever this is, chances are it had a physical component. Prison life's never good, no matter what your health, but especially if you're not well and you're stuck in there. There must have been a fair amount of discomfort for Paul, and then there was prison life in general. You're deprived of exercise and human contact. The food probably is not all that good. Comfort isn't usually mentioned in terms of prison cell. And all in all, I'm sure it was a terrible challenge. But in the face of that, what kind of attitude does Paul display? What would be the tone of a letter that you wrote from jail? It would probably not be very upbeat, but as you know, this letter is not gloomy at all. Quite the contrary. What Paul expresses in this letter is to the Philippians is joy, abundant, uncontainable, overflowing joy. Not only is he joyful, but he counsels the Philippians to be joyful, even though their situation leaves a lot to be desired. This is a church which at that moment had big problems. For one thing, it was filled with people. It wasn't perfect. It wasn't unified. And apparently two key leaders, two women in the church, were at odds with one another, and it was causing a real divide. As if that wasn't enough, the church was also being challenged from the outside by false teachers who came with false doctrine that was calling them to turn away from the grace of the gospel. So it's a church with challenges within and pressed from challenges without. And yet Paul says to it, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. How can he say this given the circumstances and theirs? This is what we'll want to figure out over the next several weeks. We need to know how we can flourish in the midst of adversity. In fact, we need to figure out how Paul can flourish in adversity. You see, Philippians gives us a rare opportunity. We can study a man under tremendous amount of stress. It's no ordinary man, as you know. This is Paul, the apostle of our Lord. This is Paul at the end of his life. This is Paul, the fiery Pharisee, who's been transformed into literally a new creation. This is Paul, who reflects in himself how Christianity expresses itself in a real world with real problems. In other words, if we look carefully at Philippians, we'll discover how it is that Christianity works in prison, in church, and under any circumstances. So I invite you, let's begin this journey with joy, because that's the central theme of Philippians. And let's begin with our ideas about joy. And we all have some ideas about joy, what it is, how to get it, how to lose it. And it's important to get in touch with those assumptions. Otherwise, when we hear Paul talking about joy, we might read in his remarks what we assume about joy. And this could be widely off the mark. In fact, I suspect that to the degree we've been influenced by our contemporary culture, our ideas about joy are going to differ from Paul. So I invite you this week, take a few minutes, read through Philippians, so that when we come back together next Sunday, we can all be literally on the same page.
Hi again, everyone. For our third and final song, we're going to do Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. I know this is a song that a lot of people know, and it's one of my favorites. It was my dad's favorite song. And if you ever see my guitar that I have at the church, it has broken chains on it that was given to my dad, and he put it on his guitar because of the song. But yeah, I think it's a good song for, you know, everything we're experiencing, you know, in the world. But the idea of my chains being gone, I've been set free because God ransomed me. I really like that. So sing along again. Words still in the description. Yeah. That's the wrong chord. Better.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My
My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace.
I want to close just with some personal notes. I realize how unusual our circumstance is, how little we know about each other, how for many of you, this may be the first time we've even had any contact. And for those of you who have had the privilege of meeting wearing masks, I still have lots to learn and lots to know. So I can't claim to really know and understand Mount Vernon Church. But I do know about your history. I do know about the contact that I've had with so many of the elected and unelected leaders of your congregation and with a tremendous staff. And from that history, this is what I know. You're a people who care for Jesus. You're a people who care for each other. Any church that puts up with any preacher for 24 years is an amazing church. And I don't say this to be an offense because I just believe it's really true. I don't know there's any perfect pastors, just the way I know there probably aren't any perfect churches. But you put up with the highs and the lows and the good things and the bad things, the genius ideas and the dumb mistakes of a man of God for many, many years. In those years, you stuck together in challenging times. You faced crises for survival. You fight crises for how to be a witness in the community, crises for how to pay the bills, and crises for how to decide about how to have an effective mission in the community and in the world. Those are all the reasons why I believe that the lessons of God's word, and for the next few weeks, the lessons of Philippians, are particularly appropriate for you and me as we move through challenging times together and hopefully do it with grace, love, faith, and yes, with joy. God bless. Stay healthy. Please keep the staff, friends, and members of Mount Vernon Church in your prayers as they shall meet the challenges of dealing with COVID. Pray for good health and recovery, and pray for blessing, not only for our church community, but for our larger community, Allegheny County, our state, and certainly at this moment in history. Pray for our nation and its leaders. May God bless you, and I look forward to seeing you next week. Take care.